All right. Hello, everybody. I'd like to start by thanking the organizers for giving the opportunity to present my work. This is something that we published in January with Amos Yarom and Christian Jensen. And so the main question that we want to address is how to formulate fluid dynamics from first principles. This is as opposed to some phenomenological construction of fluid dynamics, because we want to understand what are the set of constraints which are the ingredients of this system. And I have to say that this work is very much inspired by some other work led by Mukund Rangamani and by Hong Liu. So first principles. What first comes to mind is a path integral and some low energy Wilsonian effective action. But this is a hydrodynamics, so it's a system which is out of equilibrium and at finite temperature. So the conventional path integral approach, which is given on some real-time line, is not enough. Because we don't, the final asymptotic state is not a simple state. So for this kind of system, it is better to use the Schwinger-Keldysh path integral, which is taking the initial state, evolve it with some real time, compute the correlators over there, and then evolve it back in time, where the initial state is defined. So in this way, we avoid to know what is the asymptotic future of the system. So what we take is, we want to understand now in particular, what is the low energy effective action of this type of path integral. And we don't know how to do this arrow, so we don't know how to derive this. So we take an effective field theory approach. We need to define what are the infrared degrees of freedom, and we need to define what are the symmetries of the system. So the symmetries can be inferred from the microscopic definition of the partition function. Say, for example, if you have the sources on the two real-time lines, and you take them to be equal to each other, and you see that by using the unitarity of the evolution operator and the cyclicity of the trace in the upper formula over there, you can see that the partition function trivializes. So it becomes just the normalization of the initial state. So this means that the partition function doesn't depend anymore on the sources, on a certain amount of sources. And the dual operators are, the correlation functions of them are all trivial, are all zero, exactly. So this defines what we call the topological Schwinger-Keldysh sector. And on top of that, if the initial state is thermal, which is the case at hand, there is another topological Kubo-Martin-Schwimmer sector. And this can be seen by this second symmetry, the full KMS symmetry, which can be obtained by interpreting the initial state, the initial thermal state, as some evolution in imaginary time. So by crossing it across the anti-evolution operator, the second source picks up a shift in the imaginary time. So we have two topological sectors, and we want to implement them now, and the other symmetry, and there are other symmetries which I haven't talked about, and we want to implement them at the level of the effective action. So what we do is, and what other people have done also, is to use two topological sectors and to constrain it with two BRST-like symmetries, so to construct this type of structure. And we can geometrize these symmetries by using superspace, so by two superspace coordinates. So we combine all the fields which are present in the game and also the ghosts which have been introduced by these BRST symmetries in some super multiplet. And these O's are combinations of the infrared degrees of freedom and the sources. And the most general effective action that we can write, we write it then in a superspace with two superspace coordinates. And it's a function of superfields, derivatives, and some other supercovariant derivatives that we can define. So this first part is how we can encode the topological sectors. The second part is how we can impose the full KMS symmetry, which was the second symmetry that I talked about. It's some conjugate, some Z2 symmetry conjugate which gives a conjugate Lagrangian of what I wrote. So I haven't talked about the infrared degrees of freedom, but what we've done in the paper is consider the probe gauge field and the diffusion. So what we want to do in the future, and what it's work in progress, is to try and understand the full dynamics of the stress energy tensor and understand the entropy current in superspace. And this is also work in progress also with Raja Marje. And I have to say that this whole formalism is also useful because it's not only giving you hydrodynamics, but it encodes not only the retarded correlators, but also some symmetric, advanced, and all type of time-ordered correlators. So it can be possibly applied to systems, stochastic cosmology, or some other condensed matter systems. And another motivation that I always have in background is the gravitational counterpart. And this is also some work in progress with Jan de Boer and Michael Heller. And this has to do with eternal black holes and other stuff. Okay, thank you.
Questions for Natasha? Okay, if there are no questions, let's thank Natalie again.